Hello and welcome back, Capsule, to my channel. Today we are going to visit a nice ship, and I'll be sharing a fitting guide for the Prophecy battlecruiser, so a bit different to the main scope of this channel, which is basically more looking at what you can achieve with an Alpha account. But unfortunately, my Alpha clone, which I'm leveling, is still in the making, and I still need 1-2 weeks to get him to tech level 7, where I will be able to start making video and showing off a bit what can be achieved in terms of end game content for a free-to-play account. So today we'll be focusing on this Prophecy battlecruisers, and basically what I wanted to achieve is a step up from the previous ship I was using, which was a Harbinger. And I wanted to upscale sort of the range kiting build that I was using, and my objective was to get a ship with over 80-85 kilometer range and maintaining a DPS in between 450 and 500 cold. And looking at the different ship trees, especially on the range side, and without looking at the attack battle cruiser, because at the time I was only tech level 7, the only option basically were the Galente Memeden or the Amarr Prophecy ship, and they are very similar in terms of what you can do with it. Of course, the look of the ship is completely different. I mean, the Memeden is very special looking, and it's a like or don't like issues, but when you look in terms of the capacity of the ship, they are very similar, and we briefly gonna look into that. So when you look at the Prophecy, you see the whole banner. So basically what you get from just flying the ship is an increase in the drone control range of 15 kilometers. So that was going in the right direction for me, as I was wanting to get a kiting build, a range kiting build in there. So a free 15 kilometers range was really nice, and that's why I went for a drone gunboat in that concept. Two other skills are really important for the ship, which is basically the advanced medium drone upgrade, which give you a 30% DPS per level. So it means that when skilled to 5, which is my case, you get 150 additional DPS, which is a nice boost from the base one, and you get a 5% drone velocity, meaning that your drones are moving faster when shifting from target to target. This is the first difference in between the Prophecy and the Memeden. The Memeden gives you a bonus on the drone base hit points, okay, so they will be more enduring and more resistant. But for PvE content, which is the main driver for my game style, velocity is more important than the EHP, because my drone don't get shot at by the rats. And so moving from one target to another at a fast pace means I can clear out anomalies or encounters at a faster speed. And so the ISK per hour is slightly improved. Next is battlecruiser, and in there you get, for the Prophecy, a 4% armor increase resistance. It means that basically if you are at level 5, which I'm not yet there, I have only 4 level in battlecruiser command, that gives you a free armor hardener. Okay, it means that your resistance will be increased compared to the base level of armor that you would get with the ships. And this is the second main difference in between the Prophecy and the Memeden. The Memeden will give you more of a bonus to your armor repair efficiency. So both ships will be armor tanks, but one will give you, I would say, inherent resistance, while the other will increase the speeds at which you can regen your damage on the armor. So basically comparing the two, I would say that Prophecy is certainly more suited, in my opinion, to PvE content. And the Myrmidon I would choose more when doing maybe some PvP content where the opponent will start shooting at your drone, and so the drone HP will be important in that context. And again, when you get maybe more exposed to damage and then getting additional repair capacity will be nice as well. So that's where I would see the difference, but that are very slight. And basically I'm pretty sure you can achieve what I'm doing with the Prophecy, with the Myrmidon, with no point. Other skill that will be useful for ship, well, of course, anything that goes with Battlecruiser. So of course, Battlecruiser command, the engineering skill, and all the other skills that will improve your resistance will be nice. Anything that goes with drones, so basically the drone skill, which gives you additional range, but also the medium drone, which will give you additional damage and other bonuses to the use of your medium drone. So that should be your main focus if you want to have this this kind of fly, this kind of ship. Medium drones and battlecruiser skills related will be nice. And in addition to that, I would say, as this is an armor tank, of course you should be focusing on armor skill and remote armor skill, and we'll delve into that a bit later on in the video. So now that we have covered sort of the comparison between Myrmidon and Prophecy, as well as the basic skills and traits, we can have a more detailed look on the fittings, and we will start with the internal rigs, because as I was mentioning, the main focus of the build is range kiting. So you see that for the weapon rigs, I went for drone control augmenter. Those are level 3, which give you a very nice plus 15% 15 kilometers range, sorry. So it means that in total I got 45 kilometers additional range. Those don't come cheap, so the market wise there are 130 million, so that build is quite expensive. Okay, don't be fooled. You're looking at a ship which is certainly over half a billion in terms of both hull and fittings that are in there. But so if you want to get a range, there is no other options. You need to have the range augment 3, and you need 3 of them. There is no room there for damage boosters or whatever. In terms of the engineering rigs, so I went with OWAP core stabilizer. So this one, to be honest, this is something that you could potentially change. It's there because I've lost the ship because I was not able to warp, so I wanted to have some warp stability just to make sure that if I get swarmed, especially in the storyline mission, if I can get down enough of the ships with jamming capacity, I would still be able to warp out if I was in difficulty, even though maybe one or two might still be scramming me. So if you feel comfortable and you are sure you will be able to manage that, this is something that you can certainly swap. And there are many options that you can change to. One certainly is something that will help you manage your micro warp drive, because we'll see in low slot you have one that is very essential to maintaining the range there. In some situation, you could say have additional capacitor management, either additional cap or something that will increase the rate of regen. But to be honest, with what I have now, I've never had any issue with capacitor management. And the third option that I would maybe suggest as an alternative then would be to get something for the power grid, because if you get a larger power grid, potentially you may be able to use the high slot to get additional very long range DPS. If you can get some form of large strike cannon in there, potentially that can support the build. This is something that potentially I will explore in the future and replace, but today this is what I have, and this is working fine for me. So second point that I have in engineering rigs is a targeting a system controller. Always nice to be able to lock on a faster, especially battlecruiser, and not the fastest locking ship. So helping on that side will help you overall getting rid of the very fast ship that will try to move towards you and get you down faster. And the last engineering ring is something to help manage capacitor, and so I went for a level 1 semiconductor memory cell. I didn't have the money to buy the level 2 one, they are very expensive, and I was already overspending on the drone range controller, so I went for a level 1. But to be honest, on the long run, now that I have several weeks of using this ship, the level 1 is sufficient, and not necessarily you need a level 2 or more to be able to use the ship efficiently. So that's for the rigs. So now if you go to the high slot, mid slot and low slot. So high slot, to be honest, you can put there whatever you like because of the range difference you will have in between the drones. And you see here I have a maximal range of 88 kilometers. So this is not the maximum I'm gonna achieve because I'm still lacking some drone skill, both the advanced and expert. And so the maximum I will be able to manage is 95. And this is my end goal. I will continue to train and I will upgrade that up to the maximum of 95 kilometers. Not only because it will make the ship a bit more efficient and be able to be out kiting additional ships, but also because basically it will serve any other drone ship that I would be using, especially on the battleship side, which I will be creating and building when I will be reaching tech level 9. So in there today I have a pulse laser, so I went for Joust. Why pulse lasers? Because I was upgrading from an Amarr ship, Harbinger, so I already had the skill for that. They are quite decent in terms of striking speed. So what do I want to have for those high slot is something that would help me manage any fast ship that would not be destroyed by the drones before reaching me and be able to either whip me or scramble me. And so the pulse lasers have a very decent tracking speed for a medium weapon, and the range is nice as well. So you can start firing in between 20 to 25 kilometers. The downside is that it is not necessarily helping on capacitor management, as you see that is quite hefty in terms of activation cost. So in the future potentially I may look at replacing that with rapid fire missile launchers, but today I don't have the skill, so I do prefer to maintain the pulse lasers. I would not recommend to go for the railguns, the sub-nose railgun. The DPS would be higher, but the range would certainly not be on par. And regarding the auto cannon or strike cannon, most likely the tracking speed would not be sufficient to achieve the same goal. So the two options that I would vote for are either the pulse lasers as I have there, or the missile launcher. I didn't try to fit a large missile launcher. I've seen that on some build, because I don't have the skills for, and two, the range is still way too low. You achieve like 60-65 kilometer base range, so I didn't felt like investing in that would really mean a big difference in there. As I said before, the only thing that I will try to look at and investigate is whether by replacing an internal and increasing the power grid, I can maybe replace one of the pulse lasers by a large strike cannon, because that could potentially help on the long range DPS. looking at the medium slot, so you see here I have 5 drones. So you can look at different ways of filling the drone slots. I've seen some people having 5 thermal damage doing and dealing drones. This is fine. Personally, I wanted diversity on the damage type. Why diversity? For 2 reasons. The first one is that I wanted to capitalize on having the best damage type compared with a shield or armor, and so that's why I have the EM dealing drones and I have the explosive dealing drone damage type, 2 of them each. And the 5th slot is either, I mean, that's a Vespa, so that's kinetic. You could go for thermal. The idea was that I want to fool the reactive hardener, so I didn't want any ship either in PvE or PvP to benefit from the reactive hardener, and that's why I wanted a mixed damage type compared to what you can see on other builds where you have all 5 with thermal DPS. As you can see, I achieved my objective of a minimum 450 gold. I'm at 400, nearly 460 now, and I still have some a drone skill to move to. So I'm hopeful to be able to maybe not reach the 500, but maybe the 575, 580. Once I have everything up to expert level 5 in the drone and drone skills. In the other 3 mid slots, so this is again some items where you can have flexibility. So this is sort of the basic layout that I use for all of my ship. I got 1 webifier and 1 warp scrambler, and the scrambler is there for any ship that would use micro warp drive, so they would be slowed down and can be taken out either by the drone or by the pulse lasers. And the webifier is the same but for the afterburner running ships. Again, if you are fairly confident that no ship will breach your inner barrier and get near 15 kilometers, you can change that. I have seen other builds where you get a more tankier and you get 3 of the large group armor repairs. That then can help you release a low slot where you can get an additional damage amplifier and then boost a bit your DPS as well. But I wanted something a bit more flexible, so I went for 1 armor repair, 1 scrambler, 1 webifier. This means I can potentially do some a PvP or low sec anomalies or null sec anomalies, and if I get jumped in by a solo ship, I can hold my ground and potentially deal with him adequately. But this is where again you can have some flexibility in there. You can change depending on what type of encounters you're planning to do. You need more tankiness, then you can remove 1 or 2 of the scrambler webifier to put a remote repairers. What I've seen as well is people using target painter. Personally, I didn't see any difference on the drone DPS, any significant one, so that's why I removed it with a large group armor repair, just to get an additional tankiness and safety a belt in case of something going haywire or me doing something wrong and being maybe skipping something and needing the extra armor repairing in there. But basically you get a bit of flexibility in your mid slot, and you can rearrange the fitting as you see fit. Low slot, so that's fairly standard as well. You need to get something to deal and maintain the range, so I went for a micro warp drive. Why the micro warp drive? Because it's basically push my ship up to 1000 meters per second in terms of speed, so I can maintain distance and orbiting for fast ship, especially the elite battleship that you can have sometimes in the higher tier encounters. And as I'm not expecting any ship to be able to scramble me, this is why I do prefer to have the micro drive over the afterburner. But it has a cost, of course, in terms of the capacitor management. So when you start using it on a more extended period, you need to be careful on your capacitor management. Then of course I got a damage amplifier, so I got one bad drone and two Mark 7. Again, just a matter of ISK and farming ISK to replace them all three by bad drone. But to be honest, the difference is not that significant. When I'm moving to a hot DPS, I get like 10 difference in between the Batten and the Mark 7. So I'm not sure that it's worth the ISK to change. But 3 is nice. What I'm trying to achieve is to get the activation time up to 30 seconds. So it means that with 3 I would be able to be on a permanent hot DPS level. And I think this is achievable if you push both the small, medium and large drone skill. You should be able to be at 30 or very close to 30 seconds, which means that 3 damage amplifier would provide you with a consistent DPS. Of course, you can activate all 3 at the same time if you need to spike. But when you range kiting, basically what you want to achieve is more of a stable DPS, which is reflected both in terms of how the drone was selected, but also in terms of how you use the damage amplifier, using one, and then when it's on cooldown, using the second one and the third one. And with the 23 seconds, I have like, let's say 10, 15 seconds in between the 3 use, where I revert back to the cold DPS, which is around 460. And then the 4th slot, I had Corellium C times, a medium armor repair. That is basically because I wanted to have some additional capacity to repair my armor. For the basic tier 17, tier 8, tier 9 mission, this is not really necessary. But when you're doing the endgame encounter for the storyline arc, like the 20 or 30 million ISK where you have elite, then this is really, really useful and helped me manage that. So that's it for the fittings. So if you look at the defense, so you see that with my current skill level, I have an overall defense score of 34k. That's okay. So I got 7k in shield, about 10k in armor, and you see already the impact of the skilled battle cruiser skill, where my explosive resistance has been already improved due to the fact that I am level 4 in there. So I'm still expecting when I'll be reaching level 5 that the overall resistance of the armor will still increase, and so I should be close to 40% in explosive and being the lowest of the resistance. In terms of structure, nearly 8k, which is nice, means you can still survive a few hits on structures, and that helped me at some point to finish off a elite battleship and not having to warp out to a station or to a stargate just to regen before going back. In terms of capacitor, well, you have seen I'm not capacitor stable. Everything running, I got 1 minute, nearly 30 seconds, but this is mainly due to the micro warp drive. To be honest, when I'm lazily kiting at 85, 86 kilometers, my capacitor hardly go down below 70-80% because of the use of the damage amplifier. So it's no big deal. You don't need to be afraid of that. This is plenty of juice just to do so. Targeting wise, scan resolution and all. Yes, it is a battle cruiser, so you're not locking as fast as what you would do in a frigate, but your internal rigs and engineering rigs will help you a bit with that. And navigation wise, already have a base speed because of my battle cruiser skill of 230, will slightly increase with the level 5 skill. But more importantly, when I'm on the micro warp drive, then I go to 1k, so it helps both for looting after the encounter is over, and it helps with the management of distance when you are I would say in more tense encounters and you are very fast and very powerful ship moving to you then toward you, then you can use the micro warp drive to maintain the distance, let the drone do their stuff, and then resume AFKing the encounters. As the second part of the video, I will be showcasing a tier 9 encounter, so 5 million one, the Galente, and you will see that the basic strategy is very straightforward. You warp at 100 kilometers, you target first and orbit what you think will be your last target in the wave. So usually this is the battleship or the battle cruiser, depending on whether you're on T8 or T9 mission. You start orbiting it at, in this build, 85 kilometers. So I tend to not orbit at the extreme range, but leave 1 or 2 kilometers in between, and then you strike your targets as the fastest moving towards you, and then you go up the chains. The only change I would make to that strategy would be when the battleship or the attack battle cruiser, which are part of the waves, is really able to do a significant amount of damage even at 85 or 86, then that becomes a priority target, and you should then down him first before moving to the cruisers and potentially the destroyers, which may remain at range. So first target is really the destroyers and the frigates that will be moving at a very fast pace toward you. Then, depending on the damage that you receive, either it's the battle cruiser, battleship, sometimes the sniper cruiser can be a priority target as well on tier 8 mission, and then you move to the rest of the waves. And so next I will be showcasing so the tier 9 encounters. I will of course accelerate, so you don't have to endure about the 30 minutes it takes me to clear out the encounter, so I will speed up like 5 to 10 times the time lapse, so that you can see a bit the ship in actions and see the actual performance. So thank you for watching. Don't forget to like or subscribe if you find this useful, or leave me any comments in the comment section. I'm always happy to improve either on the video quality or the information provided. So any comments welcome again, as I would say. Thanks, and see you soon on the channel.